Hi, this is Denise, and the first thing you're going to notice is that I don't say from Four Square Micro Farm. And as the title says, I've had a name change. If you follow me on Instagram, which I encourage that you do if you want more consistent updates, I've been, really struggling with where I want to go with my crafting, fiber arts, and all that kind of stuff. Slash, I don't know if I really want to say struggling, because to me, crafting is like part of my nature, so I'm always doing something. But I've been encouraged by a lot of friends to try to market my skills and sell my goods. And anyone who's been watching for any length of time knows that I'm not real big on sales. And when you tell people that you're not big on sales, they try to encourage you further because they think that maybe you have some type of insecurity, or you don't really know how good your stuff is or stuff like that. And it's not even about that. It's about selling is a skill that I really don't have, and mostly it's because I've never enjoyed it. Like, even as a kid, selling stuff for fundraising or those book clubs or all that kind of stuff you did, I just never enjoyed that type of thing. Even I think I worked in a retail store for like 2 weeks. I don't like selling things to people. I don't like being sold to. And so when I say that I don't sell, I'm really bad at selling. What I'm saying is that it's not something that I enjoy. I like to share what I'm doing, share what I'm making. I like to give things away to people when it's reasonable. And so selling is complicated. It's marketing. It's advertising myself, which I really don't like to do. And so I think people find that odd because I'm making videos, I'm writing articles, and stuff like that. I'm showing stuff on social medias, but sharing what you're doing and teaching something you love to people who are interested is a whole lot different than marketing yourself with a goal to share or to sell. And if you're constantly trying to sell something, you're trying to find the trends, you're trying to get into the market, and it changes the way you craft. And let's say that you're not trying to get into trends or you're not trying to get into the market. What still happens is you're still influenced because you feel like if you've made something, you've spent all this time into it, and then you're kind of anxious about whether it's going to sell or not, because you can't just make stuff and use up time and resources and it not sell. And this is cool. You have a whole different perspective when you're just crafting and you make something for yourself or somebody else. You don't feel so much like you wasted time and resources. And it tends to me, it sours the craft a bit. So I decided to take a step back from that, which is not saying that I'm not selling anything. It's just saying that a lot of pressure I was putting on myself for the past year to market my stuff and get it sold, that's no good. That's pretty much no good, because I wind up with a bunch of stuff that I'm not using for myself, I'm not using for others, that I was trying to sell. And it just time and resources. It takes up time and resources. So anyway, all that to say that, and with all the changes I've had in the past year and couple of years, that I found that the whole Four Square Micro Farm, as I had put it together, for quite some time, it's been years that I've been using that, no longer fits what I'm doing or pretty much what I'm trying to do. I've been trying to hold on to that for a while, and it's just not something that fits. So it took me some time to think of something else that will describe where it is I'm heading, what is I'm planning to do. And as always, well, not always, but as usual, I took my inspiration from a song. And basically, the lyrics of the song just say that I want something beautiful to touch me. And that's almost the sole purpose of everything I do in life, especially the crafting. I just want to make something beautiful. I want to see something beautiful. I want to experience something beautiful. And I want to draw out what's in me that is beautiful. Things that are lovely, the things that are pure, the things that are good report is a Bible scripture. And I just want those things to be expressed. And so it seemed like the perfect name. So Foursquare Marker Farm has changed into Something Beautiful Handcrafts. Now, mostly on most of my social media platforms, I have gone ahead and changed the name. However, I just finished 150 little stitch markers for Plyaway, and I had already put together the packet before I made the official change. So I didn't change the links. All of the links for Foursquare Marker Farm will work, and probably right up until, I'd say maybe the end of August. And then I will change all of the links over into the Something Beautiful. So Pinterest has already been changed. Facebook has already been changed, or at least the title has. The link is still there. I've already changed the Etsy shop as it is. But I know on Etsy, they place names side by side for 45 days. So the link will still forward there for Foursquare Marker Farm, and the name will be there for a while. YouTube, the name has changed instantly because I changed it on Google. But the Foursquare Marker Farm link for the YouTube channel will still be active until I change that, and for Blogger. Okay, now, so that's pretty much how that's going. I feel a little guilty because I have not posted a video, and I looked and I realized I hadn't posted anything since January, and I haven't done any blog updates since November. There have been some groups like the Weaving with Handspun and the Spin by Design that I have not really been into for some time. And like I said, part of that is because I wanted to really go into overdrive for this business thing. And I had an assignment for an article for Spinoff November, December. And that will come out in the summer, I believe, of 2020. So that takes up a lot, because it's not just writing the article. There was a project. And of course, since I do everything from raw fiber, you can imagine the kind of time that took up. So that was that. And I did manage to spin the yarn for the Spinoff mittens. And I'll show you that in just a moment. But that will, there's a video for that one already, which was the last video I did. So I need to finish these, and then I'll finish the video for the mittens. And then I went to a fiber show, Wild and Woolly, here in Ohio, and just making the things from that December to the first week of February, really, it was nonstop, took a lot out of me. And I think that was the tipping point where I decided that, no, I really can't, because I'm neglecting the things that I enjoy. And the thing about fiber shows or selling anything is it's hit and miss. So you do all this work, you put all this out, and you don't always get the return, you know. And it was a wonderful show. It really was a wonderful show. And I did make back the money that I spent on the table, and I made back the money that I spent on supplies. But let's just be honest. There was no way to make back the money that I spent on time. And no slight to the show or any shows, but if I had gone to work at Aldi's for minimum wage and worked the same amount of time that I worked to get these crafts ready for the show, I would have made triple the money that I made at the craft show. So when you think about being self-employed, or you think about the craft show life, or you think, oh, I've got this craft and I'm just going to go out and make buku money, it doesn't always happen like that, and it most certainly doesn't happen overnight. I've been working at this for some time, and so you kind of have to weigh, you know, whether or not you can realistically live off your craft. And there are people who do, but it's not a cakewalk. And so when it comes to effort wise, 9 to 5, I think, is going to be my best bet. And also when it comes to peace of mind, it's really cool to do something that you love and make a living at it right up until the time where you don't love it anymore because you're trying to make a living. Okay, so I'm just going to stop that right there. And if anyone has anything they want to know, or any questions or comments or such as it is, then I can talk more about that later. But okay, so anyway, that's what's been happening. So I am finishing a pair of thigh-high leg warmers for a friend of a friend. And that poor person has been waiting so long, but I've been like completely bogged down with trying to make stuff for these craft shows and events that I just have not really done much hand knitting. Custom orders are just, I think this will be my last one because they are very labor intensive, you know, especially when you're knitting large items. And you don't really get back all the time what you put into it. So pretty much at this point, I'm going to make things for my videos. I'm going to make things for demonstrations. And if whatever I've made is something that someone wants, they're welcome to buy it. But I'm not making things, hand things like this to sell. Okay, so let me finish this row. But while I'm finishing this row, let me tell you what I am making to sell. I have decided that what I'm going to sell, if I'm going to sell, is I'm going to concentrate on woven or knit scarves and shawls, and mostly from luxury fibers. I've got to make it worth my time and make it worthwhile. Also, what I'm making is stitch markers. You know what? I've never been a big user of stitch markers, but I really enjoy making them. And these are actually what sells and what sold most at the fiber show. And so these ones right here are like some of my favorite. I love peppermint candies. I'm like a big peppermint flavored peppermint mint chocolate ice cream, just peppermint. And so when I saw these beads, I was like, this is incredible. I have to have this peppermint. Look at these guys. They're so cute. I also saw some candy corn ones too, but I thought maybe they were a little too seasonal. I don't know. I have to think about that. But these are the cutest little guys. They come in a set of 5. Let me see. Yes. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The only thing about these ones is that they are particularly heavy. So I would not recommend them for lace weight yarns. You probably want something sport and heavier. And this, I want to say offhand, is a 10 millimeter jump ring. So you should be able to fit a size 11 or at least a size 10 needle into this one. They Also, if requested, I can put the clasp on the back so that you can use them as row counters or as crochet markers. Okay, so here are these guys too. These are some of my favorites. And they have the alphabets on them. Oh, there we go. That's better. You can see them. They have the alphabets on them. So you can use them as stitch markers and row counters. And they have both hooks on them. So there's a little hook right here to use it as a row counter. I don't know if you can see that. And there's also a ring on this one to use it as a stitch marker. So if you don't need it as a row counter, you can just slide these off. And make sure you store them somewhere so you can find them later and pop them back on if you need them. These beads, they look heavy, but they're actually fairly light. So they should work fine for lace weight yarns. And I think the maximum size for the hole for the stitch marker is probably about a size 5 or 6 needle for this one. I make them, well, I can make the put the ring, of course, on for any size needle that anybody wants. So if they wanted these in a larger size ring, that's not a problem. Or, you know, make any of the adjustments on there. That's pretty easy once I've actually put these guys together. They are really cute. And they are in my Etsy store. This guy right here, this bead comes in several different colors. So it can be customized. The peppermints are as they are, and they are, well, both of them are glass beads. And they are a more expensive bead. And I price these basically on the expense of the bead. So the more heavier expensive beads, of course, are going to be more expensive. Even though this is a larger set, this is a heavier, bigger bead and more expensive bead. That's pretty much how that works. So that's basically what I am selling, because people got upset when they were like, oh, you're not going to sell anything at all. No, it's not that I'm not selling anything. I still am maintaining my Etsy store. It's just that there are some things that are not economically viable because they're harder, more stressful for me to produce. And they kind of are not as enjoyable when, you know, you're trying to force a product. So anyway, that's where I am with that segment. Woo! Okay, so because this is a studio blog, I don't quite feel so bad about going on and on. Because I always feel like I'm going on and on in studio blogs. But I guess that's the purpose of it. Okay, so at any rate, if you haven't seen the video from January 2020 about the spinoff, Mid-Along, I think is what it's called. This is the yarn that I was spinning for the spin along. Okay, so this is a baby doll alpaca blend. It's a 50-50 blend. And I'm going to be honest and tell you how I feel about this. First of all, I want to say as a disclaimer, for those of you who like baby doll South Down yarn or fiber, it's very possible that the baby doll fiber that you have encountered is different than the baby doll fibers that I have encountered. So this may not necessarily apply to you. It's also fairly possible that the baby doll fiber that you have encountered is the same as the baby doll fiber I have encountered, and you just like it. And that is perfectly all right, because I've met people who refuse to spin Angora and they have their reasons, and it doesn't matter if it's long or short, they have their reasons. I have people who refuse to spin Cheviot and they have their reasons, and we could be working with the same Cheviot. I could love it and they could hate it. So it's totally understandable. If you're raising baby doll South Down fiber and you're upset about what I say after this, I'm truly sorry. Like I said, we all have our likes and opinions and dislikes, which is why there's a couple hundred breeds of sheep. There's all kind of reasons to have them. Okay, so What I'm going to say is that I seriously dislike baby doll south down. Okay, and there are a couple reasons. First of all, it's a south down. So it is a medium fiber, and sometimes even the down breeds and the hill breeds have some sheep that are softer than others and coarser than others. So there's still a range within that breed. So we're dealing with a medium fiber that could range down the course. And to me, south down is always a little on the coarser side than Dorset. Well, no, I shouldn't say Dorset, because Dorset's a little on the coarser side than Suffolk. Suffolk just seems springier to me. It's not always as coarse. The Dorset and the south down always seem a little coarser. So, and they have their place because I use them and I have them. So that's not a too big of an issue. The number one issue is it is terribly short. 1 to 2 inches. I think actually 1.5 inches is the longest I've ever seen it. Here it can get to 2 inches, but I haven't really seen it. And still 2 inches is just too short to me. I really don't like short fibers. So what I'm dealing with is a very curly, a very short, grippy, coarse fiber. Not my favorite. But I'm going to keep going because I only have a few more days until the spin and mitt along is finished. Though I could, in that conceivable time, spin something totally different and knit it, but I won't. At any rate, so here it is. And I'm going to change the pattern I had originally intended, which I said in the first video. I'm going to do the owl pattern off Ravelry, which is one of my favorite patterns, with the little owl in the middle of it. And then see how that goes. Haha. All right, for a third segment, I've been working on polymer clay mugs, and this is how this started. I want to say, 2 years ago, I decided I wanted to make some stitch markers and some other random things from epoxy. It seemed like a good idea at the time. And my little epoxy venture didn't quite work out the way I had intended. And one of my friends suggested that instead of epoxy, I should work with polymer clay. Because polymer clay is a great way to make stitch markers and other little knitting charms and things like that. And of course, it took me a little while to work into that. But here I am with the polymer clay. And it started, I wanted to make some knitting mugs. And somewhere I have the mug with the little knitting basket on there. And it's really cute. It worked out well. And these ones were done by stamping into the polymer clay. And the stamps come out pretty nice. And it would fit on the cup like this, which is neat. Sometimes you paint them, sometimes you don't. It depends on what you want to do, but it's really cool and it deserves its own whole separate video, which I will do. And then I got some molds. Ooh, sorry about that. Now, there are very good ways to do these flowers sculpting by hand. You can also use molds. And here we go. This is a flower mold. It is the cutest thing, basically, I have ever seen. I can't believe I waited so long to do this. So I did put a couple of these in my Etsy shop. I really love this. I think this will be great for craft fairs in the local area. And some molds, some by hand. But they are just really cute, really gorgeous. They're kind of pricey, though, I got to tell you. I looked at the a couple of them that were on Etsy, and they are expensive. Now, I have my thoughts on that, but it is what it is. Okay, so those are the flower ones that I've been working on. They're going to be pretty awesome for Mother's Day. One thing I would definitely say about the sculpting with the polymer clay on the cups is you want to, for me this seems like the best way, to bake these on the actual cup, because they'll take the shape of the cup that you put them on. And then what I do is I pop them off and then glue them down. Now, there are some people who glue them down prior to putting them in there, and that can be done. But me, I do like popping them off, because what it allows me to do is actually, ooh, and there that one goes. What it allows me to do is to make several of these and have them, like I said, ready in hand. And I can place them on special order with whatever color cup. So anyone who's buying is not restricted to the actual cup that I make them on. I can just order, if you want a white cup, I can just order a white cup and then place them on. So it makes it possible for me to make quite a few of them in advance, which is really cool. Me selling stuff. Okay, so this one is a free sculpt, freehand sculpt, no mold. And it's a cupcake, and it deserves to have a cherry on top. It's really cute and cool. And I wish that I had the video, and I don't have the spoon. There's actually a matching spoon for the flower ones. I haven't made one for the cupcake yet, but for the flower ones, where the flower sits on top of the spoon portion. It's so really, really cute. And I saw the cutest one on YouTube, where the lady made a fist, a Hulk fist, and put it on the spoon wrapped around. Now, what kid would not want that? So you're probably going to see a lot more of these polymer clay items. I'm really enjoying the cups and the different little charms. Thank you for those who have subscribed. And if you have any comments or questions or anything you'd like to hear me talk about or see me do, please let me know in the comments. I don't make as many videos as I'd like to a lot of times because I'm just not really sure what people are looking for. So send me your ideas and I'd be more than happy to make a video on it. All right. Thank you. Have a great day.